Okay, thank you. Hi, everybody. This is my first time ever being webcammed. So I'm like, I don't usually have a microphone on my drawing table, but we'll make this work. I did this drawing last night just to have something to paint, and that was big enough. I'm glad I made it big enough. And just kind of to show you guys how watercolor behaves. What I'd like to do is I'll start painting and I'll talk for a little bit about watercolor, and then I'll open it up for questions after a few minutes. So let's see. I did have a brush right here. Okay, the first thing to remember is never set your teacup or your coffee cup next to your water cup. So this is actually my water. I've got my paper taped down. I'm using watercolor paper, or it's not watercolor, it's a water media paper from Opus. It's their brand, and I did a lot of testing of papers before I did Spam and the Sasquatch, because I wanted to get a paper that would be smooth enough to draw with ink on for the comic, and then also take the watercolor well, because most watercolor paper is kind of bumpy. And so I tested about 5 different things, and I wrote a blog post about it. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay, I kind of feel a little boomy, so I didn't want to talk really loud. So I'm going to start with just doing a wash over the rocks in the background of the mermaid here, and show you a couple of tricks. Watercolor, a lot of people think, is a very hard to control medium, and it depends on how you look at it. It is something you have to work with. It doesn't always stay put just where you think it'll be, but it's also a very forgiving medium, believe it or not. Like I could, for example, if I didn't like this that I just put down, except that I do like it, so I'm not going to touch it, actually. But but if I didn't like it, I could just blot some away quickly while it's still wet. I'm working with it dry here because I've got more control that way. If you work on wet paper, you have to be willing to let it have a little bit more of a mind of its own. I kind of compare watercolor versus other mediums as sort of cat-like, you know, like the oil or acrylics kind of stays where you put it for the most part, and it's kind of like a dog, you know, you go sit, stay, and generally it does. But with watercolor, it goes where it wants to some extent. You can open doors for it, and it may want to go out the doors, but it won't go out until you open them. So it's kind of, that's what I think of being. It's sort of cat-like. So I'm gonna just, now you see I've done these with the, just painting on the dry, and you can see that it's, you know, pretty much stays where I want it to be. You'll notice I'm dipping my brush in back and forth as I go, and it's because I kind of have a sense of how much paint I want on the brush. And I've been doing this a really long time, so many times I don't test it, but usually, and I should have gotten this out before, usually I do have a testing strip. Especially when I'm doing comics, because I'm often switching back and forth with colors, and I need to test the colors. So usually I keep a strip kind of right here in this little crowded space next to the microphone. And so sometimes you might want to use it wet on wet. There's still a little paint in the brush. I would start with the darkest color, wouldn't I? that gets the water all dirty. Usually I tell my students to have like several big containers of water sitting next to them so they can wash their brush out in one and get clean paint or clean water for the paint afterwards, but I'm not following my own directions here. But just so you know, like, you know, do as I say, not as I do. So pretend that's clear water, but now you can see it because there's a little bit of paint in it. And so when you add some paint to the water, you can see that it spreads out, and you can get these lovely sort of fuzzy effects with it. Oh, there's a place where I went over tail, so I'm just going to blot that off. And this is really nice for painting anything that you want soft edges on, like rocks or shadows or bushes. And you can sort of, while it's wet like this, you can kind of just shove the paint around in the water. So I'm painting these in sections rather than doing a wash over the whole rock area, because this way each rock will have a distinct look to it. I could have just painted them all with the indigo. This is indigo paint, by the way. And but then I would have had to go in and take each shadow out by hand and everything. And this seems to work a little bit better. Okay, I'm going to show you every watercolorist's favorite trick, and that is salt. So when you do the salt trick, you need to get a pretty thick bunch of paint in. You need to get the salt open. You need to put a little salt in your hand because it has to be done very quickly. And this is just ordinary table salt. This is probably, because I use sea salt, this is sea salt. Regular table salt sometimes has sugar and other additives in, so I like the sea salt best. So you get kind of a dark bunch of paint going here. I'm working very quickly because you have to get it on while it's still pretty wet. So I've just sprinkled a wee tiny little bit of salt on it. You don't want to get it clumped together too much, or it won't do the thing. And what happens what happens is that the salt absorbs water, and with it some of the pigment. So around each little grain of salt, it's going to have like a little snowflake kind of thing as the paint dries. It takes a little bit for this to happen, so I'm going to just continue painting up here, and I want this to be a little bit lighter. Do any of you stick your tongue out while you paint? May have gotten this paint on a little bit too thick. I see that this is starting to happen already. This is a Daniel Smith paint. There's a lot of different paint manufacturers, and I mostly use Daniel Smith paints, and I have a few Winsor Newton paints. But I like the colors from the Daniel Smith. This indigo is my absolute favorite color for doing shadows or rocks or anything that needs a cool shadow. This is just really nice. It's way better than Payne's gray because it's already cool rather than being neutral. There we go. Can you guys see this kind of happening here on the webcam? Is it? Well, you can come up and look afterwards. It's a really neat effect. It's so tiny. We'll put the salt back for now. Oops. And this is very appropriate because it's salt water, right, that the mermaid's living in. And you don't brush the salt off until it's all dry. Otherwise, you'll smear the thing that it's doing, the salt thing. I'm just going to quickly touch in the rest of these rocks, and then I'll start painting colors. Any questions at this point? Oh? I hear whispers. This brush is a number, oh, it's a big fat brush, number 8. And it's, I like using as big a brush as I can for any given area. I didn't bring any of my really big brushes because I thought I'd be working smaller than this. But this is actually pretty good for this size. And I find that the brush sizes differ from manufacturer to manufacturer. So that's why I just say, oh, I need a brush about this big when I go in to shop for brushes. This is a synthetic Daniel Smith Series 75, which they don't make anymore, but which I have had for over 20 years, and it's still just in great shape. I like the synthetic brushes. I know a lot of people like the natural hairs, but I find them kind of floppy for what I do. I like my brush to have a little bit of a snap to it. Oh, there we go, there it is. Okay, now let's see. Does anyone have anything they want to see particularly? Because I can probably apply it to this. Blend more than one color. Okay, you got it. Okay. Let's do her tail. She's going to have a purple tail, so I'm just going to get the whole area wet here around where I want to do this. And I'm only coloring up to the lines. With the coloring. I'm only putting the water right up to the lines because one of the characteristics of watercolor is that if you put a puddle of water on a piece of paper, it'll add color to it, it won't go any further beyond the boundaries of the color because it's, what do you call it? There's that little skin on the water, surface tension. I was imagining, you know, when you fill up a measuring cup kind of thing, and meniscus, yeah. So actually, I don't even need really to do her tail because I should do that separately. But I'll show the blend. So if I'm going to blend a couple of colors, I'll get the paper wet first. This is taped down, by the way. I didn't stretch this paper. For this size of paper and this weight of paper, it's 140 pound, which is an archaic thing, meaning about 300 grams per square meter. And it's quite thick enough that it doesn't need to be stretched in terms of traditional watercolor. I don't know if any of you have ever done that, but you put the water in the bathtub, and then you wait till it's all wet, and then you staple the heck out of it and tape it down, and then when it dries, it's like a drum. But you don't really need to do this. That's only if you're using tons of water and stuff like that. If you're doing comics or tiny paintings, no, you don't need to do that. Okay, so we've got this area is soaked pretty well. Let's get to some purple. My very messy watercolor box here has all my little custom colors in between. Let's see how much I got on the brush. Okay. I refill my box from tube colors because I like the colors better than the ones that came in the box. So you can see this is spreading out and getting really soft on the edges. Let's just, now I'm going to switch over to a magenta. And this is another of those working quickly kind of situations. I usually blend my colors on the paper rather than mixing them in the tray, unless I have something that I really want a lot of a particular custom color for. When I did Spam and the Sasquatch, I had a color of green that was specific for when the Sasquatch came around. And so that color I mixed a whole little container out of. And then I just used it for the whole thing. I just went over the lines, so do you. Now you see how it's getting a lighter area where it's blending here. I'm gonna try and just blend that in a little bit more. And that's because the water, there's more water in the magenta blend than I had on my brush for the purple. Here I've gone over the lines a little bit, so we'll just, it's not going to matter too much because that's going to be dark background, but just take it out. Purple and green don't always mix that well. So now those two colors are very close, and I knew that they would mix well. If you're mixing colors that are further off from each other, you might want to do a little swatch here, like I would take some water, which isn't too blue yet, and let's mix, can you see this, my swatch paper here? Okay. Let's mix some phthalo green on one side. This is a way of creating neutrals, is to mix two colors that are across from each other on the color wheel. So I've got a kind of blue-green, and I'm going to add a reddy orange to it. So you can see how it's not what I was talking about. It doesn't actually go outside the boundaries of the water. So if you want to have a boundary to an area and be sure that it doesn't go anywhere, this is a good way to do that. Like if you're doing vignette kind of things, just wet the paper and let the paint do its running around until it hits the fence. Okay, so if I blended these two together, I'm getting a really nice, rich gray here. It's kind of a warm gray at the moment, but if I put more green in it, it'll cool it off a bit. So that's, if I was going to do something like that on the paper, I would test it out like this first. I just want to see how that color looks. Not that good. You guys aren't getting a really wonderful color representation up there on the screen, but as I said, when I'm done, you know, feel free to come up here and check out the colors. Oh, can you see the salt? The thing? The salt thing? Yeah. Yeah, it worked. Okay. Any other questions at this point? I could. She's actually got a dolphin kind of a tail, but this is just for a demo, so sure I can. She's a little wet yet, so I'm going to paint. I'll paint some of the background. I know, I'll do her hair, because hair is always fun, and that's always something people would like to know about. So I'm going to turn it upside down, just so I can get at it here. Okay, what color shall her hair be? Green? I like that. Yes, you have green hair. Okay. Pardon?
I said I always like working with green because I find they blend really well with like all the colors around it and natural
Mm-hmm. And that's because the natural world is mostly green. Yeah, she says she likes working with greens because they blend really well with the colors around them. They're, in a way, green can be a neutral in that way. They sort of tie everything together. But there are more than one way to get green. I have a whole lot of greens, actually, in my paint box because I like using colors straight out of the tube. But I also, I just filled a new one with all the colors that I didn't have in this one. So I have some really interesting greens in here. I've got an olive green. I've got something called cascade green, which is perfect for painting fir trees. But you can also get really nice greens by using blues and yellows. So I'm going to pull out my favorite blue blending, green blending blue for making greens here. And I'm just going to give her a wash of this blue over her whole hair. This is a cerulean blue. I love that how I can just scribble until I get to the edges. I've started, actually, the last comic I did, I got a lot more fiddly with things and started doing a lot more detailed stuff. And when I did Spam and the Sasquatch, it was really very loose. I wanted to keep the watercolor feel pretty, watery feeling, I guess. And I didn't get real fiddly with whether I stayed in the ink lines or anything like that. And then the last one that I did, I found that I had to have a lot more detail in it to tell the stories that I was telling. And so I started using smaller and smaller brushes. And that was an interesting experience because I haven't really used little brushes for a long time. One of the problems with using small brushes for a larger area is that you start getting brush strokes. The watercolor dries really fast, and it dries before you can really get a good area covered, and so you start getting these little fiddly things, overlapping things, and it can be interesting if you're using it to make a texture, like fur or something. But if you just want to cover an area with a nice even wash, then it's better to use a larger brush if you can. And a good brush will have a nice tip on it, and you can actually make quite small details with it. It takes practice. When you get a new brush, it's a nice idea to just do a bunch of just play with it. Make a lot of marks, see what kind of marks it'll do. There's different shapes of brushes. I have in here just two shapes. I've got the flat brush, which is nice for covering large areas quickly, and also for making very straight square strokes. I like the rounds for the most part for doing comics because there's often a lot of little areas that you've kind of got to work around. So now I've got this nice blue on here. Let's turn her green. I'm going to grab a yellow that's as close to being a sort of neutral yellow as possible. If I was to mix an orangey yellow with the blue, you guys know what happens when you mix red, yellow, and blue together. You get a neutral color. You can get, depending on how dark they are, you can get a almost black with it. You can get a gray. You can get browns with it. Just depending upon what the ratio is. So if I've mixed an orangey yellow with a blue, then I've got some red, yellow, and blue in the mixture. So you want to be careful which primary colors you actually do use to mix. So here we go. Green. I sometimes use this blue to tone down some of my green colors. This yellow is, I'm trying to remember the name of it. I'm not really sure. It's been in there so long, and there's like just a little bit of it left. I was getting ready to replace it, actually. But I haven't done the color testing with my colors to figure out what it was. I did that. I refilled a bunch of these recently and couldn't remember what colors were in there, so I had to do all these swatches to find out what I had put in there to start with. So it's a good idea to write these things down. Well, I did write it down, and I put it somewhere. Who knows? But the color testing was fun. I really like doing color swatches and mixing color swatches too. I have notebooks full of little tests that I do. I draw little squares on the paper, and then I just do little mixing tests, and it's very meditative, actually. So if you feel like painting, but like you don't really feel like painting, you know, you don't feel like drawing something, just make some color swatches. It's great. Okay, so now what this has done is it's given me some areas that are more yellowy, and some areas that are more bluey, and I'm not blending it entirely, because that's part of the way I like my watercolor to look. I like there to be some kind of back and forth with the color, because if you're, you know, if you look at nature, that's how color works. You don't see you don't see a rose that's like a flat red, right? It's all different colors of red and pink and yellow, and they're all blended together. So I'm gonna let that dry for a little bit. Sometimes if I was in a really big hurry, as I have been at some demos, like I sometimes use a hair dryer to dry things off. Usually it dries fast enough that I don't have to worry about that. But sometimes if it's really humid, it can be. You can need to use the hairdryer if you want to get on to your next step. Okay, so we asked for scales. I'm going to take the same blue here that I used in her hair. I'm going to start. Start a row of scales. So now I'm painting, this is dried off pretty much. It's not quite dry, it'd be better if it was dry, but because I'll get a little bit of bleed, but that might be all right here. So I'm gonna just sort of paint, trying to paint around her little beads. I'll go back and color those separately later. One thing I sometimes do for scales is I'll draw in like a pattern that's sort of a crisscross pattern all the way around. I'm not going to do that here because it's still wet. And you notice these are getting a little bit lighter as the paint on my brush runs out. And that's all right, because that's what's going to give us some variation. My mermaids are actually going to have, for this book, are actually going to have kind of freckles and stuff instead of scales and dolphin markings. This is meditative too. Okay, everybody say om. So I've kind of got enough of a start here. I think you can see what the pattern would look like. I'm not going to go all the way down with it, just because it takes a while to do this kind of thing, and it's I don't like to rush things. If you ever feel like you're wanting to get something done, slow down. Like, seriously. Because when you rush watercolor, its mind gets even more of its own, and it's not good. Okay, let's see. Let's do her skin. Because she's a mermaid and she's underwater, she's not going to have normal kind of skin color. But I will make her, for the sake of this, I mean, normally we'd be getting a very blue light here, but I'm going to give her a little bit of a warm skin tone to start with, and then I might wash some blue over it. So usually when I'm doing skin tones, I usually start with a burnt sienna, because it seems to have everything, you know, in its range. If I put it on really diluted, it's very light, and so I can do white people. And if I put it on dark, I can do dark brown people. And then if I need to get more into drawing like black skin, I'll use a burnt umber, and sometimes even add a little bit of indigo to that. But let's just give her a very light wash of the burnt sienna for now. And we'll add a little pink to that afterwards. So really light, just enough to kind of... And again, I'm working kind of quickly here just to keep it moving around, because otherwise you get blotches, and there's no place that shows up more than on when you're working on skin. When I'm working with something that's diluted, then it's possible to just go straight in with the color. If I wanted to make her a darker color, I would get the paper wet first, so that the color would spread around. But this has got so much water in it already that it's not really a worry. Her fin's going to be purple too. Oops, he's a little bit dark. And with this light of a color, I don't really have to worry about it if it gets, you know, on her lips or something. In fact, it's kind of good to have it as an undertone for lips. Okay, a little more water. And you can pick up if you've got a little too much on somewhere, or if you want to put a highlight in, you can dry your brush off and it'll pick up the paint. Okay, now while she's still kind of damp, she's underwater, let's give her a little bit of pinkness. Well, nice complementary color to the green hair, right? And get this on quickly enough. And the face is the most important part, not to be blotchy. And I'm just doing the tops of her arms and such, because the underneath, I'm gonna give her some shadows. And one thing that I like to do for shadows, besides the indigo, if I want a warm shadow, then I use purple. And Ken Stacy must not be in the room, because he'd be cheering. He's the one that taught me about purple for shadows. So let's just... It works really nicely with the burnt sienna. because it kind of they kind of neutralize each other. And it just so happens that it makes her blend really well with her fins. Is that train again? Usually I'm turning the paper around quite a lot when I'm working so I can get a good angle on it, but I'm a little bit confined here. And when you're drawing or when you're painting, it's actually, there, I just picked up some extra paint. It's good to have your paper free so that you can work with it for the stroke of your hand, because we all have kind of a natural arc to the way we can move our hands. And if you're always trying to work the same way, you know, with the thing in the same direction, you're having to turn your hand around in a lot of unnatural angles and you won't be able to get your whole arm into it. So do turn around your paper when you're working. Okay, let's see what we've got here. What did I just put on my brush? Ah, magenta. I'll just get that on her fin there. Is this relaxing? I like watching people paint, other people paint, because I'm not doing it. That's a little bit dark. This purple is one that's kind of a staining color, so if I put it down and decide it's too dark, I've got to get it off really fast. Now notice this is not like portrait level painting or anything. It's I tend to try to keep things simple for the comics, and I'm really not even keeping them simple enough. I've decided that I really have to try and get a little more comic booky with my painting style. Planning to learn how to do some digital drawing and painting, like using Illustrator this summer, so that I can sort of get an idea of what it, you know, just blocking in solid blocks of color can do. With the watercolor, it just, because it's doing its own blending and stuff, sometimes it's tempting to really take that blending and get really fiddly with it, but keep it simple. Watercolor will do its thing on its own and just, you know, make these really nice gradations without having to get in there and actually paint every stroke. Oh, where am I? Oh, I have forgotten her tail. How's our time looking? Is there someone in the house keeping that? Pardon? 4 more minutes, all right. Well, in that case, you guys better ask me some questions. Okay? Well, this is inked. I penciled it last night. My penciling is very, I think of it as sloppy. Some people tell me it looks really tight, but I think it's pretty sloppy because I sort of tend to go like this until I home in on a line. And then I just ink it and erase it. I used Pigma Microns for the ink here. It's a good idea anytime you're using a new pen or new pen brand, to test it out with the watercolor and make sure that it's not going to bleed, because some of them will say permanent, and they're not. And you'll be very sorry if you've gone to all of that work and then suddenly you find that it bleeds into your colors. Other questions? Do I see one up there? No questions? Okay, I'll just keep painting then. We'll see if we can finish up her tail a little bit here. Oh, I know. I wanted to finish doing that hair. So now if it's dry enough. Pardon?
You said you had students, so you teach?
I do. I teach watercolor classes in Victoria at Monterey Center. It's a senior center, but the classes are, they have quite a lot of arts classes, and the classes are adult level. And I'm teaching a comic course there, a six-week comic course, just once a week in the fall. I taught one last winter, or this past winter, and which was tons of fun, just really, really a hoot. So I'm taking that same blue that I used before on the hair, and I'm gonna put in some shadows real quickly here. I started with it pretty dark, and then I'm gonna pull out, just got my brush wet, and pull it out to make it fade. And this is something that I do a lot. This is one of my favorite techniques for getting a gradation going, is just to start with it dark or semi-dark. Wash off the brush and take the water off of the brush, because otherwise you'll get back runs, which can be fun. And then just sort of make it spread out gradually. Actually, I should show you guys a backwash. Backwashes are fun. I'll do the seaweed down here, and I'm just going to use a green directly. Let's use the sap green. Good old standard sap green. And if you paint a fairly dark. I teach one class. I teach beginner classes in watercolor, and I teach one class called Watercolor Magic Tips and Tricks. And it's what we do all day is just play with the paint. We don't try to paint anything. We just play with it and make it do weird stuff. So this is one of the simpler things, is just to drop some water into it. Alcohol is really fun to drop into it because it makes little planets. It's great for doing interstellar art. So you can you see that bloom that's happening there? And that's the surface tension of the water pushing the paint out of the way. Watercolor is based every kind of paint has a binder to it. It's pigment plus something sticky to hold it together. Basically, some kind of glue. Acrylic paint has acrylic medium, which is the glue, which you can use plain as a really nice glue. Oil paint has various oils, linseed oil and such. Watercolor has gum arabic as the binder, and because it's soluble, it'll be wet as well. I didn't get any paint. So that's what the water is pushing out of the way, is the gum arabic, which carries with it the pigment. That was your science lesson for the day. Let's put another couple of drops of water in there. You can use this for all kinds of different textures. You can use it for rocks. You can use it. I really like it for bushes because it sort of looks like bushes all by itself. That's a little too even. Let's put a little couple small ones on it. I think my 4 minutes must be coming to a close. Is that so, old timekeeper? Okay, so we'll just wind this up then. Any last minute questions?
How long do you have to cut weeds before you can actually dry wash?
If I was going to put a glaze over it, you mean? Yes, yes. If I wanted to put another color over everything, I would wait till it was totally dry. I might even wait like a whole day, just to be sure. That was supposed to be a rock. there's one thing. Oh yeah, the other thing that you can do for getting texture into stuff is wad up a paper towel and blot, and voila, texture. So it's, you know, printing. You can print with all kinds of things, actually. You can get very creative with that. Well, thank you all very much for coming and watching me paint. And that was fun. And if you think of any questions or anything, I'm actually at table A5. I was going to be on A6, but the people next to me didn't need that much room, so we sort of shoved over. But it's over by the windows in that corner. And I might work on this a little bit more today. And anyway, come by and look at my books. I've got the originals to some of them too, so you can come by and see what the watercolors look like in a finished state. Thanks.